home. You are home. You are in your library. You are in your vibration. I want to start it with this. Worlds beyond the poles. Written by Amadeo Gianni. Still working on getting a downloadable PDF. Many people have been looking for it. I got somebody working on that, so much love to you, brother. You know who you are. And, you know, we're going to take it from just a little bit. I just want to show you. We're going to dig through this, baby. We're going to dig through this. We're going to dig all the way down. One second, let me turn this around a little bit. Okay, here we go. We're gonna dig all the way down, baby. First edition, copyright 1959. This is a hard baby to get. It's a hard baby to get. It's about 500 at least if you want to buy it. It has a lot of great information in it. We're going to dig all the way in it after we get on these trees. I just want to skip ahead a little bit. So let's start from here. Make sure you can see that. I know it's small. Hey, I'm trying. You got the PDF, you pull it up. But I'll read it off. This is the preface. Preface. The following pages contain the first and only description of the realistic universe of land, water, oxygen, and vegetation where human and other forms of animal life abound. The realistic universe. Go. So that's a little bigger for you. Even bigger. Alright, how's that? Okay, here we go. So the following pages contain the first and only description of the realistic universe of land, water, oxygen, and vegetation where human and other forms of animal life abound. This is not work of fiction, nor is it a technical analysis of anything. It is a simple recital of fact which transcends the most elaborate fiction ever conceived. It is diametrically opposed to the assumptions and the mathematical conclusions of theorists and technicians throughout the ages. It is truth. These pages Describe the physical land routes from the earth to every land area of the universe about us. The physical land routes from the earth to every land area of the universe about us, which is all land. Such routes extend from beyond the North Pole and South Pole. So-called ends of the earth are decreed by theory, like gravity is a theory, not a law. It is fake. This person, this Gianni, is breaking down land that extends to the celestial. You don't go up to get to the heavens, you go straight. Eventually, you'll run right into the heavens. You need to go ahead and relax. And if you're interested in hearing how your world really looks without the hijack, buckle up. Knuckle up, get ready to fight the static. You have to fight your hijacks. Fight your hijacks and get the truth. It will here be adequately shown that there are no northern or southern limits to the earth. It will thereby be shown where movement straight ahead from the pole points and on the same level as the earth permits of movement into celestial land areas appearing up or out from the earth. They only look like they're above you. You look like you're above them. But you keep going straight, and you'll see it's only an illusion. It's only a mirror. An original treatise basic to this book was written and has been expounded at American universities 1927 and 1930. Since then, the United States Naval Research Bureau and the U.S. Navy's exploratory forces have conclusively confirmed the work's principal features. Since December 12, 1928, U.S. Naval polar expeditions have determined the existence of indeterminable land, extent beyond both pole points, out of bounds of the assumed isolated globe, Earth as postulated by the Copernican theory of 1543. On January 13, 1956, as this book was being prepared, a U.S. Naval Air Unit penetrated to the extent of 2,300 miles beyond the assumed South Pole end of the Earth. That flight was always over land and water and ice for very substantial reasons. The memorable flight received negligible press notice. The United States and more than 30 other nations prepared unprecedented polar expeditions from 1957 to 58 to penetrate land now proved to extend without limit beyond the both pole points. My original disclosure of then unknown land beyond the poles in 1926 to 27 was captioned by press as more daring than anything Jules Verne ever conceived. Today, 30 years later, the United States, Russia, Argentina, and other nations have bases on the realistic land extent, which is beyond the earth. You don't have to leave this earth, guys, to go to other worlds, right? Columbus found a new world. You keep searching, you find more worlds and more worlds. What does Heya have planned for his children? They have tricked you into thinking you're on some finite ball spinning, and the only way you'll find more land is to leave this ball to go to another ball. In reality, you go straight. Then you research the Antarctic treaties and you research why they won't let you pass certain barriers, and you say, oh, so I'm stuck here. I'm in the Middle Earth. I'm stuck here. You guard it like ranchers. We can't take our boats. We can't do our own expeditions. We can't fly over the North Pole. We can't fly over the South Pole. We can't do anything. We're stuck until we're free. Let's finish it out. Today, 30 years later, United States, Russia, Argentina, and other nations have bases on a realistic land extent beyond the Earth. It is not space. It is not space, as theory dictated. It is land and water of the same order that comprise known Earth territory. It is land and water of the same order that comprise known Earth territory. So what you see as space is really land and water. You know, the waters above, waters below, more land, more land, more land, comprised of the same order. This work provides the first account of why it is unnecessary to attempt shooting up or out from the terrestrial level for journey to any of the astronomically named celestial land areas. It relates why such attempt would be futile. These pages present incontrovertible evidence that the same atmospheric density of this Earth prevails throughout the entire universe. The same atmospheric density is everywhere. Such a feature provides that, except for the presence of a gaseous sky envelope and underlying oxygen content equivalent to that of the Earth, we can never observe the luminous celestial areas designated as star or planet, right? We can never observe the luminous celestial areas designated as stars or planets. It is shown here that in a determination of realistic cosmic values, the observed luminous areas of the universe about us represent celestial sky areas, and that they are as continuous and connected as all areas of this Earth's continuous and connected sky. Hence, it is shown that there are no globular or isolated bodies to be found throughout the whole universe. They are elements of lens deception. What have they done? What has NASA done? They give you telescopes, and all the while they've been looking at the ceiling. All the while you've been staring at the ceiling the whole time. Not into outer space, but the ceiling, because you can't see past the firmament. You can't see past the vibrational layer, and you know it. So we've been looking at observatories, looking at the ceiling the whole time. Lens deception. Accordingly, the absence of celestial bodies precludes any possibility of bodies circling or ellipsing in space. This book is $500 to $1,000 and up. Okay? I'll finish it out. This work is radically and rightfully opposed to astronomical conclusions of all ages. It depicts the illusions developing from all telescopic observations and photographs of the universe about us. It clearly explains and vividly illustrates why those lens-developed illusions have been mistakenly accepted as facts. Mistakenly accepted as facts. The book is therefore unparalleled in the long history of man's attempted interpretation and recording of the universe about us. It projects man's first understanding of the factual within this universe, which contains human life throughout its vast length and width, regardless of all abstract theory to the contrary. Alright, deal with it. And we're gonna get this right quick. The discovery of new worlds, new worlds, new worlds. Columbus discovered a new world. The discovery of new worlds in matter, as in mind, is but the logical outcome of an infinite universe. You see, when they found us here, we are a new world to them. You continue, you find more new worlds. Who's there? I don't know. But there are more. And you just have to go straight. But will they let you go straight? No. And I'll get this too right quick. I want to get this poem. Only dreams are true. The tangible and real on which our lives are based was yesterday's ideal. a rosy picture traced by some quaint visionary, impractical, half-cracked, painting his fancies airy, and now it's a solid fact. Whatever we hold as stable, dependable, and sane was once a hopeful fable of castles built in Spain. Before the fact, the fancy, before the deed, the dream that builds by necromancy the hard material scheme. What is necromancy? Let's find out. Necromancy, the supposed practice of communicating with the deed, especially in order to predict the future. Witchcraft, sorcery, or black magic in general. Witchcraft, sorcery, or black magic in general. Necromancy. Now let's read this again. The tangibles and real on which our lives are based was yesterday's ideal, a rosy picture trace. So whatever we're living in today was just dreamed about yesterday. It was yesterday's idea. You're living in an idea, people. Wake up. It was idea of yesterday. A rosy picture by some quaint visionary, impractical, half-cracked, painting his fancies airy. And now, guess what? It's a solid fact. They teach it in your school. You're on a round ball. They tell you you come from Africa. That's a fancy. Whatever we hold stable, dependable, and sane was once a hopeful fable of castles built in Spain. You think you're on a ball? It was once just a fable, a theory, like castles built in Spain. They want to tell you they built those castles, right? But that's just a fancy. Before the fact, the fancy. Before the deed, it was just a dream that builds by necromancy, witchcraft, sorcery, black magic in general. Before the fact, the fancy. Before the deed, the dream. What dream? The dream that they have you in. You're asleep. You are asleep. They closed your eyes. You're asleep. I know you think you're awake, but you're just in a dream. And they built it by necromancy, by witchcraft, sorcery, and black magic. The hard material scheme. The hard material scheme. Nothing is hard and material. We are all just vibration. And they trapped us in a material scheme. So you think you're just material. And you stop to vibrate. That's how they stole you. That's how they hijacked you. You just want to think about this. You just want to think your way back home. You don't want to vibrate out of the scheme. But we're going to wake up. It is our destiny. So we're going to tear through this. But first. Oh, wait. There's more. Oh, but there's more. By Burton Braley. So all your towers that shimmer, your lamps that light the sky, were once a tiny glimmer within some seer's eye. This seer had this witchcraft, and you were just a glimmer in the thought of how this witch will hijack your light. Time makes our empire scatter. Who cares about Israel? Your empire is scattered in time. They even switched that. But we shall build anew, for only visions matter and only dreams are true. The only thing you think is true today is the dream you are asleep in. Burton Braley had to drop. So we will be getting back to that. You know what I'm saying? Thank you for vibing in the library. Keep vibing. Send me some PDFs, man. Whatever the case is, you know how to get to me, man. Music at 432thedrop.com. All right. You know who got the drop? Marcus Aker got the drop. He knows the drop. Let's hear it from the king.
Set up with all these different videos that I want to show y'all. I just realized, like, I'm not gonna do that over again because my last video got interrupted and it ended. But I'm just gonna get to the main issues, main points, and I'm gonna show you what I can show you. So, if you Google curvature of the earth on Google, obviously, I said it if you Google, but you would see that they say every mile is 8 inches, so every mile, so 2 miles, 16, 3 miles, 24, and so forth, so on and so forth. But they're lying how they're using the form, because they're not using the Pythagorean theorem right. It's actually every mile, you square the mile and times it by 8 inches.
Right.
So indeed. If you look at Indiana, it's a part of Indiana where it's about 60 miles away, and you can see the Chicago skyline. If you use that, if you use the formula, 60 times 60 times 8 is like 28,800 or something, whatever it is. That's inches, and when you take it and use it with you convert that to inches, so you get, what is it? Do the calculations really quick. If I can open the tools, calculator. 28,800 divided by 12 is 2,400 feet.
Do you see how we're putting this together, Yasharath? We got brothers with calculators doing the mathematics. We got brothers so excited just to, you know, be reading books, different books that we're just getting all over the place. We're putting together our habitat. We're putting together our frequency. We're putting together our history, our indigenous history. And we're tying all that with our scripture, with our prophets' writings that are in stone, our commandments that are in stone. Now we're understanding. Now we're overstanding. Go ahead, bro.
2,400 feet. So I should be looking well over. I should be looking well over the Sears Tower. But yet I see the whole skyline in Chicago. But when they explain it, they try to say, oh, it's a mirage, blah, blah, this, blah, blah, that. There's videos that you can go look and show that's proven how it's not a mirage. Then if you look at the flat earth flight patterns, or I'm just flight patterns in general, internationally. If you look at international flight patterns. There was a lady, there was an emergency landing. It was supposed to be a flight from Bali. What was it, Bali, Asia or something? I don't know, but it's somewhere. I will pull a video up for you guys, but I'm not going to waste my time and waste you guys' time when you could just go do it yourself.
That's
It's like this one place on the map. I could pull up a map and just show you at least. So, all right, my fault. I broke out of video.
So, check you had out. To do it. You had to do it.
They're coming from Bali. They're supposed to land in L.A., but they had to do an emergency landing in Alaska for whatever reason. You know, off track. Emergency landing is supposed to be the shortest landing. The destination, and they land in Alaska. So check this out. I'll let him play. I said no videos, but I'll let him say what he got to say.
Alaska, way up north, on top of Canada. Okay, why is it that the emergency stopped? Went to Alaska.
Blah, blah, blah. Let's look at the flat earth map.
So, all right. Skeptic.
Boom.
Here
on that map, don't it?
They only went like straight.
A better straight shot on that map, right? Yeah.
They only went straight.
Here we have the map of the globe. These
are the point proven. Let's go look at the United Nations logo.
Oh.
United Nations logo.
Oh. Oh.
What are they saying?
Oh, same thing.
What are they saying?
That's the flat earth map on the UN logo.
These are the people that run the world.
Come on.
What are they saying?
Come on. Come
There's
on.
There's videos out there about how NASA lies about certain stuff. And if you look deep into it, you would know that every person, you know, that supposedly went into space or that's an astronaut, they're all Freemasons. Don't get it twisted. They're all Freemasons. And so they know how to lie. They know how to, you know, swear on oath and keep secrets.
Right.
And then even these guys that's flying these planes, they're sworn into secrecy. Like they can't. I don't want to go into details about that, but I know of that they got to sign a contract and say that they won't share certain information, or whatever. So they pretty much expose the bullshit that they tell us. What else? Let me gather my thoughts for a second. Did I say Walt Disney and all these other people were running, you know, help fund NASA in the beginning, and still to today they have a, you know, direct, you know, connection between each other. Like, there's a lot of trickery going on. They give us all these different images, you know, they give us all these different views on fish islands. I keep telling people, go look up fish islands when they're doing these incredible jumps from thousands and thousands of feet, promoted on
GoPro
nationally, like this last heaven sent drop. And there's even a video on that explaining, you know, how this is really a satanic ritual. But basically, you know, they use this fish islands to make you think the world is, or the earth is curved.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, when you really pay attention to it, you will see how the images change. The curve, it's like sometimes it changes on that fish islands. But when you
look at those GoPro lenses, the fish eye lens, a lot of times the GoPro lenses, whenever they do these big jumps and these Red Bull jumps and all these things like that, it's all these bubble lenses. You see the screen going up and going down and going up. So you know you can't trust the curvature because they're playing with your curvature. Right when you see the lens going up and down, you're like, why don't you just have a regular camera? Why don't you just use a regular camera? Oh, because we have to. You know, they're going to make some reason up. So y'all check this king out, man. Subscribe to Marcus Acre, man. You know what I'm saying? All right, man. Let's get to it, man. I've been teasing y'all about this tree drop. It's pretty amazing. just watched it for my third time with Chef Candy. We both, man, we just got our minds blown. Alright, so let's get to it. You know, now we're ready to see our habitat, and let's continue to open our eyes and see. So we need to take a break, go do what you gotta do, and I'll be here when you come back, I guess, you know. Here we go, flat drop. There are no forests on flat earth. I implore everyone to research and watch this doc on your own and research all the drop. He has a very thick accent, so we'll try to, you know, be very quiet so we can hear all this. We won't get through the whole thing right now, but this will be probably a three-part series or something like that. And we're going to get through this as well as reading some more of the Worlds Beyond the Poles. So I'll try to do a three- or four-part series combining some reading from World Beyond the Poles, a little bit of the Abi Zayad reading as well, and some of this documentary, and maybe a little bit more. But you know, I'm gonna nail down this habitat, man. You know, I'm passionate about where I live. I'm passionate about what the earth, what the creator created for us, what earth the creator created for us. People that say it's a distraction, you are a distraction. You are a disgrace that you don't care this much about your habitat, that when people go crazy about the habitat, you consider it a distraction. Something's up. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of things distracting us, and this can be definitely a distraction if you get too caught up in one part of it. But you, when you look at scripture and it says firm, fixed, and immovable, and you still think you're spinning on a ball, and your scripture keeps repeating firm, fixed, and immovable, and you know you can't find one real picture of earth on Google anywhere, you don't ask no questions. You just keep quoting the oppressor to get facts. You want a fact? There are no forests on flat earth. How can it be that there's no more forest? I see trees all the time. And I say, open your eyes. Let's get to it. Love to y'all. Let's learn together. Let's grow together. Hey, hey, hey. Hey. Oh, you gonna love this.
This loud headline, even with exclamation mark in the end, every sensible person will say that I'm out of my mind and will throw at me millions of photos with images of forests. I want you to believe this is another trick. They made us think that this is forest. Actually, you are looking at the 30 meters bushes. This is total bullshit and nonsense, you will say to me. Of course we know how forests look like. We all walked and strolled in them. Well, expected reaction, and it's fair. But after listening or reading this chapter, its headline won't seem strange to you, because you will overturn your concept of forests 360 degrees. And now, first things first. We will begin with well-known picture. Children see 9 dolphins on it, but adults see 2 lovers. A huge difference. Do you agree with me? Make yourself find dolphins now and find out how it's hard. Feminine fruities will flatly refuse to transform into dolphins. It's funny, because children's problem will be exactly the opposite. This is the first fact. The picture is single, but we see it completely differently. What is more, children and adults can't exchange perceptions. Why it is so? It is simple. I see the way that matrix ordered, but not the way the real world looks like. Our eyes became traitors over time.
So when we see through the eyes of a child, you're literally seeing the entire universe differently. You see dolphins, not 2 lovers. You see dolphins, man. Dolphins. I'm keeping it real. I'm looking at that and I can't find, I gotta go back to find, I still can't see the dolphins. But a child can, I'm going to try this with my children. I'm like, what do you see? I can't wait. And that is the key. If they change what you see, if they don't, if you can't see dolphins no more than what? All right. Roll with it, man. This is a beautiful ride. Surf the wave.
We were blinded, yet in childhood.
We were blinded. The
outward world. It's quite different. We see things through prism of habit and experience. And this prism distorts everything very, very hard. At 30 years of life, this prism gets status of mind protector. And at 40 years of your life, you can go crazy without this prism. You think I'm exaggerating? Look at this photo. I am claiming that this is mesa that was formed from a magmatic melt from the Earth's deeps about...
So, I know his accent is thick, so he's saying, I'm claiming that this is a mesa. You know what a mesa is, you know, you look it up, it's a flat, like a flattened out mountain with a flat top. They call them mesas, cliff mesas, mesa verde, mesa, mesa. He said, well, I'm telling you this is a mesa. Now, everyone knows, they see this is a tree stump. But he said, nope, it's not a tree stump, it's a mesa. It's a mesa formed by some volcanic eruption. Alright, that's what they're going to say. It's a mesa formed by volcanic eruption. Not a tree stump, a mesa. Follow him.
200 million years ago, you think I'm out of my mind? In my turn, I can blame you in the same sin. You will understand soon. We will come back to this grass plot lately. And now, let's remember how we bumped on the old Stroud trees. Sometimes even take photos, trying to hug unhuggable stem of the tree. But really, think about it. Old trees are rarity. They are all registered. They are tracked and are kept reserved like a memorial of nature. There were uproar in the network about forests. Why all forests on the Earth, even in Siberia, are not older than 200 years? Where are giants? And it is right that people are roaring about it. But I want to step to this question from a different angle, from the sides of the Earth's poles.
Okay.
The thing is that even Soviet biologists found strangeness in the poles. A natural amount of water is kept in ice and snow, and there is a natural percentage of carbon dioxide in the world's ocean. These abnormal concentrations tell us exactly about worldwide fire of the past. Using simple math, those scientists came to conclusion that those fire carried away 99% of Earth's biosphere.
99.
We all know that living cells are consists of hydrogen and carbon. So those ice on the poles are made for the most from water, from burnt organisms. And now think about this number, 99%. It means that everything that now grows, crawls, flies, swims, and runs on the Earth is 20,000 times less in volume than was before this catastrophe. 20,000 times.
Wow.
To imagine this, look at this picture. This piece of bread is humans, plants, and animals. Just this pathetic small piece of bread near the car that represents Earth's biosphere before those times. I hope you understand that today's myth about overflow of population is just a pure hoax and nonsense, 100%. But here's a problem. Biologists divided this number between all continents and nothing succeeded. There is no so much place on the dry land to place it. This theory cracked at the seams, but snow and ice are there. It's not going anywhere. Fact is fact. It must be placed on the land. But as always, illumination comes on a sudden. Stereotype of thinking is to blame. 30 meters tall forests is like a virus penetrated in our head and biologist's head and prevented to find solution to this problem. If plants can feed broadwise, then we should feed them upwards, and everything comes clear. In this new theory, hypothetical forests of unthinkable height was drawn. And here's the thing. We found these photos. This is vandalic felling of the sequoias in the California Redwood.
Wow.
In
look at that.
1880 till 1920 that I survived.
And he'll get into this in a second, but if you look closely, if you pull this up, you'll see it for sure. Inside the tree is a bunch of little hexagonal, you know, like honeycomb structures. It's a honeycomb, like it's just a honey, you know, same thing as like the salt flats honeycomb, like a bee's honeycomb, which lets you know that this is an organic situation here. And that this is the same way you'll see everything grows. They call it sacred geometry. They call it this and this and that. But you'll see what we're talking about. Let's go.
By miracle, in the planet's bombarding in 1816.
1816. What happened in 1816?
How much years this tree needs to grow up to these sizes? And then comes freaks with saws and axes. One, two, and no more tree. In the proportion of these trees, we can see rule. Diameter of the stump is about 3 times bigger than woodcutter's growth. Let's look on this formula. You just think about it. You are entering the forest whose height is not usual 30 meters, but 100. Here's your fairy forest from fairy tales and books. Forests that are lost forever because of such barbarians. I understand that they are just wage workers.
You want to know what a forest looks like? You don't even know. Your eyes have never even seen a forest. These are just wage workers, right?
That they must feed their family.
They must feed their families.
It's just an order above. But if every single woodcutter refused to do this crime order, all forests will be saved. Because Mason's demons are too arrogant to do it with their own little hands. That's why I will send these merry woodcutters' defenders to a well-known place. Look at these photos carefully. They look like satanic bacteria that finishes the forest's organism. For those who think that trees were killed just because of wood materials, I want to dispel your claims. Trees are energy generators. They produce constant electricity, oxygen from photosynthesis, food. They have root network and are programmed to exchange data. Our ancestry had a theory that trees are programmed to keep data from everything on the planet and saving it in their information portal in the carbon fibers. I don't know the reason, but some sequoias these vandals left alive, even put a fence and called wildlife sanctuary. Of course, guides in the parks will tell you tales from the crypts. How in the stupidzoic era, stupidosaurs scratched their booty on this old sequoias of California. Let's summarize everything. Remains of the giant trees of the past are found, and homeless ice and snow of the poles took this place in the mosaic. It seems like everything is clear, but it's not. Nothing is so simple. If you take myths and legends of all nations, you can find lots of stories about people, animals, and plants morphing into stone. This is normal, because paleontologists all over the world dig petrified fossils of humans, animals, and plants. There are so many of them that museums are overfilled of petrified fossils of clovers, frogs, lizards, pieces of dinosaurs, and on, frogs and clovers, it's all good, but we have forest debate. Guys, where are the trees? Old sequoias of California do not fit here, because they are made of carbon. It means that they did not code the silicon era. Why I know that? First of all, they were cut and sewed by standard instruments. All X's and O's will break of silicon. So, where are silicon trees, if those giants from carbon are not related to the silicon era? Guess what? They were found, try to think where, in the same North America, in the Arizona to be precise. This zone of Aryans, there are so many things going on there. The giant quarry that now is called Grand Canyon. Like one person under the nickname Wake Up Human said, it's apogee of cynicism to name quarry wastes as national parks. It's not a national park, it's just a quarry waste. And what an ancient Russian word's root kolo is doing in the opposite part of the world, the root ra, I won't even mention. Here is even city of Aryans, from which left only the vortex that made hooligan meteorite 50,000 years ago, of course. It is how Wikipedia is telling us this total bullshit. Oh, by the way, here are our silicon trees. I want to introduce you the museum under the open sky. Stone trees here are just scattered in the desert and also fenced. Everybody today can visit this circus by the name Petrified Forest National Park. In this park, petrified fossils are not common. They are unique. If turtles and frogs were petrified in pale gray boulders, then these trees morphed into semi-precious stones. Well, admired stonies. Beautiful, isn't it? It is time to take a stock. All our forests are young and do not grow higher than 30 meters. Remains of fairy forests were found in sequoias of California, and biologists put poles, ice and snow in its place. We found petrified fossils of silicon era and trees from precious. Now everything fits together, right? Oh no, in perfect world everything is fit, in our cursed hell nothing is fit. Since that time when I was a kid and saw petrified fossils on TV show, I was tormented by the question. So it was born in child's head, but now it's cost a lot. How it is possible for the frog to morph into stone instead of rot, like all organic bodies do? Let's see what Wikipedia is telling us. Special rare conditions must be met in order for the fallen stem to be transformed into fossil wood or petrified wood. In general, the fallen plants get buried in the environment free of oxygen, which preserves the original plant's structure and general appearance. Understood? Dry British humor. If not, I'll try to explain. You need some spontaneous natural disaster, for example, volcano eruption, tsunami, clay rain, which can quickly cover frog and mammoth, made conserves from them, where bacteria won't decompose corpse to state of stinking manure. In other words, to make body petrified, you need to cover or engulf body and compact it. According to so-called scientists, the tissue was organic and then magically turned into silicon, SiO2. Remember this formula. If you have ever buried your home pets, you can quickly run and dig them out. Your beloved pet is petrified and you can put his statue on your table. Want to reproach me in black humor? Redirect it into official science community, which wraps us such a bullshit. Immured body has only two options: dry up like an insect in the piece of amber. A second option, just simply rot. Organic body will never, ever turn into rubble. Never. This absurd is invented to hide the truth. Magical morphing into stone rubbles is a little thing. Transmorphing wood into semi-precious stones, this is where the lies and ignorance becomes uncontrollable. Tell me, how stock of wood can become semi-precious stones? No answer, but I have. And we will discuss this lately. But now let's analyze this James show. I don't know how about you, but I am confused by 3 points. First of all, according to the official story, these trees fell in unequal battle against neighbor volcano. Attention, 225 million years ago. Continuation of a story is even more exciting. That would not only burn in hell's fire, not only rot it in the wet ground, but in the contrary to all laws of physics, chemistry, and biology, just transmorphed into precious gems. David Copperfield is nervously smokes on the sideline. But this is not the end. Trees are not broken. Trees are sawn into accurate pieces. Well, I want to know the name of brand of the chainsaw that Indian aborigines used for this. I'm joking, of course, but the conclusion is that this is not a museum, but staged theater. Trees were sawn, cut, and brought here by someone. You know, only true fool will believe in magic transmorphing of wood into precious stones and gems. And we have next question. For what purpose they made this circus with this broad and scattered through trees of silicon life form? And did you pay attention how small these silicon trees are? They are incomparable even with sequoias of California. But this one is simple. They are not trees. They are branches of the giant silicon trees. And those trees were so big that American sequoias near them are like little sticks near the baobab. And while tourists are gaping near these precious gems, no one is paying attention into the background because everything is hid in it, in our plain sight. To understand what I am talking about, we shall return to our favorite picture of grass plot, and I want to ask you what you see.
What do you see?
A tree stump in the daisies. But I continue to claim that this is mesa, that formed from a magmatic melt from the Earth's deeps about 200 million years ago. Do not believe me? And now, let me introduce to you. This is Devil's Tower, mesa, or so-called lacalis, that is formed from a magmatic melt from the Earth's deeps about 200 million years ago. At least this is how Wikipedia is telling us. And billions of people are believing that this is mesa, or lacalis, or mountain. Huh?
Huh? Alright, well, we saw the tree stump and the daisies around it. Now you see what they're calling Devil's Mountain or whatever the case is. They call it a mesa because it's a mountain with a flat top. Nah, buddy. That is a remnant of one of the original trees of the forest that you don't know that was destroyed. Now, whether, you know what I'm saying, we talk about these fallen angels and their technology and that they themselves cut down these trees, that the Most High allowed it to happen then, or was it destroyed during the devastation of the sinking of Atlantis? At some point, the trees were destroyed. Is there still a tree in the center of the earth? Or is it just Mount Meru that's left of the tree that used to be there? It used to be a tree, but now it's just a mountain, Mount Meru, right? Is this a mountain or is this a tree?
Really?
Really?
Let's come closer to our tree stump to look at his fantastically inexplicable columns.
Wow, look at this.
Let's look in Wikipedia once again. Igneous rock is formed through the cooling and solidification of magma or lava. Huh? What a smart magmatic melt. He just stand and frozen in appearance of perfect hexagonal columns for 300 meters in the sky.
Wikipedia.
You can synchronize your instruments on these miracle columns. Were they squeezed out of cram injector, then tied in a bun like a broom, and big giant fan blowed near to help columns to curdle fast? Huh? Maybe columns of Parthenon or Isaac's Cathedral were built in the same way? Gentlemen scientists, are you out of your mind writing in this garbage? Humans, are you out of your mind believing yes. in this garbage?
Yes.
Claiming that this geometrical masterpiece appeared as the result of lava fountain.
That's a
the
tree.
Same bullshit as claiming that racing car appears on the track because of explosion on a Ferrari factory. Have you ever seen what fountain of lava looks like? In those times, lava had artificial intelligence. Huh? Really? Comparative analysis. All columns are hexagonal. Why exactly hexagonal? Because universe's masterpieces are built in this form. There are no same snowflakes, but all of them are in perfect hexagonal shape. These two, without knowledge of mathematics, correctly identified that regular hexagon has least perimeter among all of the other regular shapes of equal area. So, you can feel this shape most efficiently. When bees build honeycombs, they instinctively try to make them more roomy as possible, spent with as little wax as possible. Hexagonal shape is the most economical and efficient figure for building the honeycombs. Blind sheep can't understand that our universe is fractal. That is why no difference in what scale you will study it, in scale of mountain or scale of tree that everyone have under their window. And now let's open botany textbook. Let's find structure of any plant and let's compare it with our giant stump. We won't go deep into this. We want only those facts that will fall into our hands from the stump's photos. So, it will be useless to try to argue against those facts. I want to introduce you a cross-section of the stem of flax. Well, well, gentlemen biologists, are you noticing anything? No?
Alright, so this is the cross-section of a real tree, what they would call today mountain, right? Like Mount Everest. Just like if you see the salt flats, they'll have the same structure. And if this is what it looks like on top, it's the same columns that will be going down. That are all individual columns that are going down. Every one of these hexagons is a top of a column. It's been sawed in half. The columns have been sawed off.
Look, seems like honeycombs in the middle. Oh, way! And they are all hexagonal. Well, well, what a coincidence. If we remove skin around this flax, our stump skin is already removed. Look at the small rocks around it. And guess what? Flax looks exactly like our stump from the bird's eye. They look identical. Exactly. Stump's fibers, like the fibers of the flax, has hexagonal shape that is strictly preserved is geometric along the entire length of the stem, and that is as much as 384 meters. I want you to pay attention that stump's fibers even stricter in their proportion that came from the textbooks of botany. The fibers are no different for the whole length, but also relative to each other. The feeling that it is a branch of armature, hexagonal cross-section, after leaving the metal rolling mill. The fibers are not attached to each other, since freely exfoliate and fall as the stone erosion goes. Each fiber of our stump is covered by a thin skin, exactly like fascia, a thin sheath of fibrous tissue enclosing a muscle or other organ. As you see, petrified skin contacting wind and moisture is cracking, exfoliate, and showed, and this is direct evidence that fibers of stump are consist of at least two components placed in each other. Fibers do not go into the ground vertically. They are gradually bent to transform into the root system, like every tree should do.
Trees.
As you see, the official story of spontaneous and accidental solidification of lava is 100% bullshit and falling apart. No, I understand that Hollywood in 1977 made film called Close Encounters of the Third Kind, with Devon Tower playing the main role, where we were told 100 times that this is mountain where we can meet aliens, but this garbage is suitable for fools only, and where your eyes were, gentlemen scientists. Hey, biologists, geologists, paleontologists, are you here? Do you study the world in the welder mask? And now let's find out the height of the tree, which this stump was one day. Let's use the formula that I mentioned earlier. The diameter of our stump is 300 meters at the base. If we sum 300 to 20, we will get the height of, are you ready? 6 kilometers. Just think about it. Everything is learned in comparison, isn't it? I think we can put a big fat dot in here. Devil's Tower is a giant stump of a giant silicon tree, with all attributes of a normal stump that everybody saw. But we should not underestimate the matrix that keeps all cattle in the stables.
Matrix.
I'm sure that even after such clear evidence, there will be deep sleeping people that will ask for more. If you think that all my arguments are ended, I want to disappoint you, because I have so many trump cards in my sleeve.
Uh-oh.
And I will enjoy every moment where I will throw them on the table.
You got a little confidence when you're rocking with truth. It flows out of you. You don't even want it. Y'all think we want to be doing this? People think we over here trying to go for glory or something? We can't shut up. We can't sleep. We're just energized, which is just information, man. But it's not just the information, it's the vibration. That's the wave you're surfing, and the information falls in line in the order of the vibration of the energy that you are, that you've been planted in, that you are the seed of your father. That's why there are seeds waking up today. It's like popcorn. There's certain seeds that are going to pop. The ones that have been programmed to pop will pop. It is really that simple. Can you graft into that? Yeah, but you just got to let what's popping be popping and support what's popping. And get down with what's popping. You dig it down, let go.
Well, we figured out everything about this stump. Let's move to another one. Yes, yes. And you thought that this is the only one. You just need to remove your blinkers and you will see so much. Let me introduce to you Giant's Causeway in Ireland. noticed something familiar. Take a closer look.
Wow.
Again, these hexagonal columns. Whoa. If you do not notice similarity with the Devil's Tower's fibers, you must be 100% blind. This is the same giant stump, but now it almost do not comes out of the ground. This tree grew right on the seashore. Giant causeway consists of almost 40,000 of columns of such geometrical proportions that all the beasts in the world will be jealous. Of course, all science nerds declared it to be National Nature Reserve, like I mentioned before, as one person with nickname Wake Up Human said, it is an apogee of the cynicism to name a quarry waste as a national park. In which connection a quarry waste here, I will say lately. But now, guess what official science bleats about this Irish stump?
Wow.
Giant Causeway is an area of about 40,000 interblocking basalt columns, the result of an ancient volcanic eruption. Volcanic eruption! Ah! Please, tell me how to stay calm and not erupt fountain of swear words in the direction of
Turn
science
up.
Society.
Turn up.
It is very hard, but I will try, because our enemies only want us to do it. I have only two questions. First of all, how many years was in coma C.C. Campbell? And second, why still these honeycombs were not declared as the result of an ancient volcanic eruption? Because they are not distinguished at all. No less strange why street sidewalk tiles are not declared as the result of the ancient volcanic eruption. Show me a single difference, nerds. And now I offer you to come back to our old method and compare Giant's Causeway with this time with real lava. I want to remind you how lava erupts and flows. And this is how it congeals.
Staring at trees the whole time, thinking that they're mountains. Do you know where you're at? Do you understand who you are? Here's my question. When we say that Moses' body is buried near Mount Nebo, is Mount Nebo a mountain or a tree? Let go.
And now let's compare Devil's Tower with Giant's Causeway. Oh, sorry. For my French, I mean, let's compare silicon stump with silicon stump. Somebody still believes in the love.
Is Mount Zion a mountain or a tree? Lego.
A fountain. If I didn't know about giant silicon trees, I'd rather believe in giant cram injector and fern, but not in volcanic garbage. If you think that these two giant silicon trees are the only thing I can show you, then you are mistaken. There are loads of them on the planet. The funniest thing that normal people do not realize that they are stumps, but official science realized seriously that they should find how to hide these trees from people who ask too much and invented genius name. Or silicon stumps, the basalt cliffs.
Trees.
I want you to pay attention to those two pictures, where real fibers hang from like the ceiling.
Real tree.
How can volcanic version explain this? Lava was dripping, but its drops didn't fall to the ground, and other drops sticked by the hexagonal honeycombs to neighbor drops, which somehow reached the ground.
Turn up.
Look at this photo. Just a normal everyday photo with this girl. It is good, but the only thing that she do not realize that she is sitting near the giant stump of a silicon tree. All artifacts are in plain sight, but prism of matrix do not allow us to see nine dolphins.
Dolphins.
There are tons of silicon stumps in the dolphins. Network. You can learn this topic by yourself. All distinctive
trees
features, you know, now, so Google will help
trees
you. And we are moving forward, and I want to show you one more hexagonal
tree
miracle of the earth, of silicon nature.
Tree.
I want to introduce to you the biggest salt lake in the world, Salar de Uyuni, Bolivia.
Salt lake.
As you see, not everything is so simple as it's written in the textbooks and shown on Discovery Channel. For our tradition, wanted to show you what Wikipedia is telling us about this hexagon.
Come on.
But if fibers of silicon stumps Wiki is retouching somehow, then about hexagonal structure of the South American lake is keeping silence like a fish. Like there is none of them. But they are there, absolutely there.
Wow.
You won't believe, but silent is not only Wikipedia. After hours of research.
So that's the same for the Salt Lake in Utah as well. You know what I mean? Those are just like flats of trees. I know your mind can't conceive this stuff. I know. You're only seeing lovers. You're not seeing dolphins. Wake up to reality. It's time to have you back. Vibrate.
I found nothing about this hexagonal structure. And only in one place I found single phrase like, look how interesting dried and cracked salt. And then I fell into a stupor. First of all, under the blazing sun's rays, every surface is cracking like this. But not in the hexagonal shape like a honeycomb. Second, cracks are deepenings between fragments of surface, but I see elevations. And this is the opposite to the cracks. It is more looks like a fiber fascia, like silicon stumps one. And third thing, why salt surface has exactly hexagonal shape? If official story has not even sensible explanation, but nothing at all, let me tell you my opinion. As Wake Up Human says, there are no salt lakes on Earth, but just sludge salting tanks. I agree with him, but not in this case. And there is why. I think that you already realized that hexagonal shape is an attribute belonged exclusively to a living organism. Either it is possession of the queen bee, snowflake structure, or plant's fibers. As we've seen with our own eyes, Salar de Uyuni, it's not just a giant layer of salt. It was a living being of silicon form of life that was scraped out by adepts of technocracy, by their machines. Now you understand how far we are from the reality. If giant tree is somehow, we can imagine with our pathetic mind, then creature from salt 10,000 square kilometers wide and unclear what height, can't imagine. Now you understand that 7,500 years ago our planet was so fantastic, fabulous and beautiful that Cameron with his avatar is poor substitute. And all is left to us is a desert, which we...
So he went back 7,000 years, according to his research. So how does that cooperate with you? He said 7,500 years. Alright. A lot of stuff is recent. Let's go.
We had turned into a scrapyard. And what I mean by saying scraped out by their machines? Well, to be short, while our society was sleeping in this matrix, walking 9 to 5 hours every day, doing useless things, dreaming useless dreams, our planet literally was scraped out and are scraping it now with giant graders and machines. I will show you later. Well, theoretical part is over now, and it is time for climax, and we are going to runway. But before, we should return to our first stamp and see one strange thing in it. I bet you did not notice it. We saw many stamps, but this one is special. He has flat surface on top. It means that it was cut down. Yes. Yes, exactly cut it. Or sewn. And now our imagination is asking us, who cut it? For what? With what they cut it? I will answer these questions lately. We will put this question into the background because this stamp that was cut is not single one on our planet. I will tell you even more. Devil's Tower is a small one compared to others. Boys and girls, our aircraft is ready to fly. Our course is, well, we have no course. We will fly our planet around. Fasten your seat belts and better hold the handrails, because everything you will see will overturn your notion of rocks and mountains. Let's go. While we are flying, let's play a game. Find 10 differences. So, there are only 2 differences. Material and size. Thank you. These stamps are sticked out everywhere on the whole planet. There are hundreds of them. Scientists call them mesas, table from Spanish, because they have flat peak, flat as table. Well, cool, stamps. And now let's remember beginning of our conversation. We thought we saw a forest and even walked in them. So what matters if they are only 30 meters high? Is there a difference? We are pleased with this one that left. We enjoy their beauty, make bacon on a weekend. We are accustomed to this forest, so we do not need another one. Then we discovered that old forest was preserved in USA,
that
which is
better.
Described in fairy tales and myths. Giant 100 meter sequoias, exactly this forest, our mind drawn in when we hear word fairy forest. On the sequoias of California, our mind is stopping, prize of matrix forces. Otherwise, our mind's protectors will melt, because Devil's Tower points to 6 kilometers high tree. But then we realized that Devil's Tower is a young plant compared to other trees on our planet. For example, mountain in the Cape Town, Africa. This is what really impressive. This plateau is 3 kilometers in diameter. If we sum 3 to 12, we will get tree of 60 kilometers high. Do you even give yourself a report how big its branches are? Only on one of its branches you can easily place huge residential quarter with all shopping malls, schools, parks. Just imagine how huge it is. Of course, your mind will never see that this mountain in Africa is a tree that is 10 times higher than Devil's Tower tree. 60 kilometers. Where do the above? But guess what? This is not the limit. In the work of our Russian scientist and poet Alexander Sergeyevich Pushkin, we can read about giant fairy oak that was on the Buyan's Island, that we now believe been killed by our governments. That oak was supposedly in the center of the earth and was some hundreds kilometers high. Not sure how high.
So this is the tree that, you know, you see in so many different, parts of the world, man. I mean, they all have this tree in the center of the earth. This fable, this foundational legend. And now you hear more about a mountain in the center, this magical mountain, this Meru. But they don't let you fly over the North Pole, right? You can't fly over the North Pole. You can't fly over the South or past the Southern Wall, the ice, the 200-foot ice wall. You can't fly out of that. They keep you away from all these things. So did they cut the tree down? I mean, can you imagine the vegetation? Can you imagine the oxygen? Can you imagine how you would grow with that type of oxygen? How healthy you would be? What have they done with the place? What has Thoth done with the place? Huh? These pantheons, these fallen ones, that can't get above the firmament, that can't get above the barrier. What have they done with the place? This place was utterly destroyed. We are living in a desert. We are fighting in the desert. We're just looking for lit, just drops and pieces of drop that's still left behind, but there's not a lot of drop left behind. From what we see around us, I mean, I'm sure there's other lands beyond the Arctic Circle, right? Beyond the ice, there's other lands that are beautiful, I'm sure. where there are trees, but we don't have trees anymore. We have mountains. We have tree stumps.
But for sure, high as at Cape Town's one, this oak was the biggest plant on the earth. Remember, in the beginning, I mentioned our prism of mind that helps to preserve it, but distorts our reality. Ask any person to show you trees on the right foot, and he will immediately put his finger on the green on the ground, without noticing that this is only pathetic bushes. Even can't say bushes, more looks like a moss in compared to this size, but definitely not a forest.
Not
now
a forest.
You can understand why we can't find nine dolphins. But do not dwell on fish and stumps. Once again, I want to urge you to think in planet sizes. If instead of dolphins and stumps, we see lovers and mountains, imagine what is hidden from us with a curtain. That's why apocalypse is translated as curtain opening. Do you now understand why I mentioned this matrix prism in the beginning, through which we are looking in, and it turned out that we see nothing? The real world is different. I can call today's state of the society a real dream, and the sad part that it is not figuratively. You know, in Russian language, word tree is spelled Дерево. The word ancient tree is spelled Дерево. And the word ancient tree is spelled Древность. It means that on Russian language, the language of Aryans, ancient tree means time when old giant trees grew. Interesting. Isn't it? Well, let's put all lyrics in the background and continue our flight. I think you will ask me, maybe it is time to come back to our questions. Who cut it? For what? What they used to cut trees? No, it is too early. We know that the whole face of our planet was covered by giant vegetation. So, we can ask ourselves, where did all other forests go? The thing is that these so-called mesas are just single ones, best trees, that were chosen for cutting. All other forests of the planet was laid down by blast waves. We reviewed only stumps with flat peak. Does anyone remember how not cut it, but broken tree looks like? I will remind you. Understood my hint? No? Let's play a game again. Find 10 differences.
How many times have you seen that? We didn't see all types of Utah drop. How many times have you seen this in Arizona? How many times? Like something just blasted and leveled it off. Not just cut like an axe, but just a straight up blast. Like the tree was just blasted off of its stump. By a unimaginable force. Does that match anything to you?
I think you understood meanings of my words. So, I want you to look at the highest stumps of our planet, that were mined like a quarry, and were broke by a blast. For example, three Everest.
This is Mount Everest. The tree Everest. Can you dig it? This is a tree, man. A tree. Your real forests are all gone. There are no more forests. Dig on it.
How you already guessed? There is no such thing as rocks on our planet.
No rocks.
That's all just pieces of broken stumps. You can look at millions of photos, but only thing that you will find is corpses of our true environment. How official science explains origin of rocks, I think you guessed too. Now you understand why we are so charmed by rocks, why all elite properties is placed between rocks, why the most clean material for the construction are pieces of rocks.
So whenever you see this, you're just looking at broken, the fibers of the broken tree. These tree were, these silicon tree are stone. There was no stone before they started breaking the tree. There were no weapons of war before they created them out of the stone of the tree. The rocks you see are the trees. And everything else, the branches, the stubble. You're walking in a disaster zone. Wake up.
Because even if they are dead, they still emit powerful energy for us, mortal carbon human beings. Stone is a bridge between silicon and carbon life forms. And now, important thing, you must learn how to distinguish rocks from mountains. They are completely different things. Rocks consist of solid pieces of raged stone with bulging to the sky fragments of fibers. But mountain is just a pile of loose waste which were brought by giant machines. It has almost perfect cone shape, like every loose structure does. Sometimes those piles has chemical waste inside. Sometimes those wastes react with each other. Sometimes they just burn, but sometimes explode. And then nerds in the white coats scream that they invented a new volcanoes. And tell immediately you as stories from crypt how 200 million years ago this volcano formed those silicon stumps, or explains origins of our streets sidewalk tiles as the result of the ancient volcanic eruption. That's why no such things as volcanoes, rocks and mountains. You can throw out those terms from your vocabulary. Okay, let's fly further. So, from our board, you saw that absolutely all rocks on our planet are just corpses of silicon form of life. They all are fallen trees, you want to ask? No, not all of them has hexagonal structure, like Devil's Tower. Some of these rocks have lamella structure or spongy structure, like our mushrooms do. Like liver is different from our heart or lung. So our ancient world was so diverse that we can't even identify or imagine lots of species and subspecies. And now let's imagine amount of the wood that must left after fall of such trees. where all these materials are. If the trees were 6 to 100 kilometers, there must be loads, tons of the wood. You know, this theme was greatly disclosed by Pavel Ulyanov. He has nickname Wake Up Humans. He made a revolution in the theme of geology and principle of bucket wheel excavator's work. Let me introduce to you. This giant cuttlefish on the photo is Badger 288, one of the world's biggest rotor excavators. And this is how those machines work. It crawls on its wheel parallel to the quarry wall. Giant wheel with ladles scratches out rock and ground to all living things, leaving concave wall after itself.
Wow.
Geologists must be hypnotized in schools while they are students, because why else they call this quarry waste miracle of the nature? Like, for example, this cliff in Australia. Want to laugh? If you do not believe in retardness of the last stage, just Google wave rock and check official explanation. 100% unbelievable how people buy into this. Some people will ask, which stone was a part of the living plant and which was not? I want to tell you that at least 7,500 years ago, there was no such thing as stones at all. Everything you can find now was a part of our ecosystem. And then people said that they want to be gods themselves and screwed everything up.
So you know when this was, when they wanted to be gods themselves. Does that match anything? So they destroy the entire ecosystem. And they built monuments out of all the stone and the precious metals that these beautiful trees were made out of. And this is how they built things and weaponry and all that stuff is coming. The entire periodic table, all the elements are coming out of these beautiful, beautiful organisms that are now all laid waste.
I want to ask you, open your minds. They live, we sleep.
We sleep.
But they not only live, they also are killing our planet. They are doing this even now, while you are watching in this. Wake up, humans! You must review all the knowledge they gave to you in elementary school, middle school, high school, history, geography, geology. Open your mind. I want you to look at these photos. Today we have lots of artifacts which we can't repeat because of certain conditions, as lack of technology, lack of equipment or specialists, and which are evidence that our civilization, at least 200 years ago and before, compared to us today, was more developed, and our today's society are just kids in the sandbox. Here is some examples. Bobolova bass. Here is what Leisman, that was near it, tells us. Sorry for my language, but they are telling us absolute bullshit that somehow master made it for 7 years and polished it every day, like Papa Carlo. Absolute bullshit. With all my responsibility as lace man of 5th level, I declare that this is machine procession. Concave and convex surfaces of this base strictly precise. Circle on the whole diameter. Very accurate spherical surface in the lower part of the base. Inside the base, on the bottom, the same super accurate concavity for the whole diameter. This product is impossible to do manually, especially to polish it manually. I have an impression that it is only yesterday got out of machine. Polish is like from Isaac's cathedral columns. It is impossible to do without high class, high speed polishing and grinding instruments. Next one, Alexandrian columns. Weight is 600 tons, 27 meters high. Without turning in this on a lathe machine, this column has shape of entasis. Simply impossible to do manually. Peru, Olante Tambo, polygonal docking of blocks. Weight is 4,120 tons. The level of adjustment, you can see yourself. Blocks are aligned in three dimensions. Capella San Severo, made from a single piece of marble. This is impossible without advanced CNC machine. For the last 50 years, there was nothing even far similar in complexity of execution has not been done by any sculptor, even with the CNC machine. Marble tombstone on Monumental Cemetery, Santiago, Museum in Genoa. Stone bridges in Sevastopol. Each polygonal stone of the bridge is essentially a single sculpture. An example of modern work with the stone is on the left. By today's standards, it is considered quite acceptable.
All trees.
All the cities on the planet were built of stone in antique style, with pre-designed layouts of streets, avenues, embankments, and so on. All cities have stone bastion wall, construction volume which is often equal to the construction volume of the city. Something about 1780 to 1815 years, we experienced nuclear war. It's likely not the first time in the world, which resulted in the nuclear winter in the 1816. A year without summer. The Anglo-Saxons call it 1800 and froze to death.
So 1800, they had the nuclear winter, 1816, these people were freezing to death. What did they do? Migrated here. They turned up over here. They said, man, for our own survival, we need to conquer all this. We need to do this and do that. Alright, so this all correlates with the story, with how things got turned up over here around that same time. You saw how the map changed and how the migration, you know what I'm saying, or the invasion took place from east to west. From that 1776 all the way up. Alright, so that's what's happening over there. They're in nuclear winters, freezing to death.
Here is some screenshots from Google Earth, photos of nuclear craters
nuclear in territories
such as Belarus. Such craters are easy to find. White traces around craters are broken limestone, the basic material of that time. To visualize the damage, search in Google Roger Ainton Crimea O.J. Robertson, Crimea.
Dig it.
And see the pictures, and you will see photos of this first war photographers sent in the Crimea in 1853 after nuclear war to take pictures of the siege of Sevastopol. Compare vegetation then and today. An example of photo of Sevastopol by Ainton. Until the 18th century, houses were built.
I mean, literally, what were they doing? What were these people doing to the environment to cause nuclear winters? Can you even fathom what they were doing to the earth? And are they any different than the people in charge now? Is it not the same damn people? When can we see? When are we going to decide to see?
Almost entirely of limestone. For cutting, we are used advanced machines to make a perfect parallelepiped. Here are some photos of the houses in Crimea. All houses in all cities of old USSR are covered with clay for 3 or 4 meters. All houses that are deepen into the ground 4 meters have such good quality. It takes 200 years, and during the Soviet era, such a masonry of limestone is considered to be very good. It is Eskiker man. Illiterate guides will tell you that it is one of the cave cities of Crimea where people live. When I asked about this track, I was told that this track is done by cartwheels of local nobility, and this is another so-called cave city of the Crimea. And this is modern quarry where limestone is mined. This photo is made before the revolution, 1917. You can see that from the rock is accurately cutted segment, the bottom of which runs the railway and warehouse is standing. And now very important photo of Inkerman's quarry, the name Champagne, made in 1890. You can clearly see cutted passageways through the rock, 100 meters in width and 80 meters of height. Under the vertical wall, we can see small pieces of limestone and limestone crumb that fell off because of working saw machine. In the cutted holes, you can clearly see houses.
So this is just all one tree. So I want you to make sure you get your perspective. This is all one tree stump. Imagine the tree. Just imagine the tree.
Some of these holes are beginnings of catacombs. Some of them are extend for hundreds of kilometers. It's conducted a large-scale underground mining of limestone. In the days of the Second World War, in the catacombs were hospitals, warehouses, headquarters. Trucks freely drive in and out of these catacombs. By the way, there are ancient catacombs at any city of the world. Near Odessa, catacombs length is 2,500 kilometers. Everything they tell us as rocks, canyons, ravines, cliffs, are just nothing more than a quarry. There are very old quarries over there, and many fresh ones. This is White Rock in the Belogorsk near Crimea. It is a limestone quarry. The wall was formed as a result of the cut slope of the hill. Want to see more? Look at the passage from which huge mass of limestone was taken. They lie to you. And guess how they call it? They call it Valley, beautiful wonder of the earth. Check this out. This is old photo from 19th century. Mount at the vertical wall of limestone chips, not yet overgrown with vegetation. This is old painting from 1855. We can see ancient giant quarry wastes in the background. Are you impressed by the scale of the mining just in little Crimea? I want to tell more. There is no cubic feet of land, probably 100 meters deep over the entire earth, which would not have been in its times mined, milled, masticated, and discarded. It is not a planet, but a giant quarry waste pit were the most violent and barbaric way. The whole periodic table of Mendeleev is extracted.
All elements are extracted from the trees that were destroyed.
Look at these photos and pay attention to the tight structure of the quarries and mines. Rotor excavators tight cuts massives. It's formed structure with right angles and viewed from above. And now I want to show you the rocks, ridges, gorges, canyons, cliffs in almost uninhabited nowadays places with different romantic names. Often they are named by the name of their discoverer. Are all academics and professors of geology and other scientific nerds do not see it? Mountain on the Kolan Peninsula, do not know the name. Mountains on Antarctica that were only discovered in 1820. Antarctica. Here even left the traces of the heavy machines and equipment. Greenland, Watkins Mountains. Look at the scale of mining. Greenland. Flight, Frankfurt, Los Angeles. Gangbjorn, the highest mountain in the Greenland. 3,700 meters. No problem. Almost completely gutted. Svalbard, Norway. Aurora Borealis, in the background of quarry, Antarctica. Transantarctic mountains. At the foot, traces of the machines are still visible. Antarctica, Transantarctic mountains, quarry system. Pay attention to the background. Mount Kailash, Tibet. The height is 6,638 meters high. Have you ever seen that in our time heavy mining equipment were raised to such heights? Goblin Valley, State Park, Utah, USA.
Utah.
Gloves Mountains, State Park, Oklahoma, USA.
Oklahoma.
Grand Canyon, Arizona, USA. It is just giant quarry waste, gutted territory. Millions of tourists think that it is almost a miracle of the world because they were told so. Quarry, Grand Canyon, Arizona, USA. Nowhere we can find traces of water erosion, only the shock explosive.
All you see is the explosion of the machinery. You see the traces of machinery everywhere now. Now that your eyes are open, you know that used to be vegetation. These were trees, man. The Grand Canyon was a beautiful place of actual, it was a real forest. A real forest. Now it's one of the biggest quarry wastelands, but they're still finding gold mines all the time. And it's right beneath your feet the whole time. You're in a real forest. A real tropical masterpiece. Not spinning on a ball, but an infinite land, energetic vibration scenario. Where you got to connect above the barrier back to Heya. Back to the creator of this masterpiece. With no hijacks allowed. Stay up, suit up, choose up. We'll be on a part two, man. Alright? I told you to buckle up and enjoy it. Just vibrate with this and surf the wave. Love y'all.